Hello, and welcome to the League of Women Voters Presents. Today we'll be discussing the Berks County Whole Home Repairs Program, and I'm Karen Parish, and I'll be your host. I'd like to introduce my first guest, our Pennsylvania Senator Judy Schwank. Through the miracle of technology, the Senator and I are recording this through Zoom. After we introduce the background for the program, we'll then move to the studio and talk with local officials who will be administering the program. Good morning, Senator. Thank you for being here.
I'm in Harrisburg in my office.
Oh, awesome. So even more miraculous technology.
Budget discussion, obviously. So this is a really timely program.
Perfect. I was hoping you could give us a description of the whole home program from the state perspective, how it came about and how and why it's funded through the Commonwealth.
Absolutely. So the Whole Home Repairs Program was actually legislation that was passed this past spring. And it was introduced by Senator Nikhil Saval from Philadelphia and quickly became a very popular idea. I was one of the co-sponsors on the bill. And what's unique about this legislation is it has a groundswell of support from advocates all across the spectrum who are concerned about the status of housing in the Commonwealth. So what does the program do? It allocates, at least in this budget year, the one that was passed previously, and the money's going to start rolling out soon, $125 million to be spread across the entire state. And what it will do is it will give eligible homeowners up to $50,000 to repair, update, or adapt their homes, for energy savings, for example, fixing windows or leaky roofs or, you know, plumbing, mold problems, lead. Some of the issues that we know we've faced in communities throughout Berks County, which has certainly a much older housing stock in some of our, the city, as well as our older boroughs. So the county had to apply, Berks County, every county had to apply if they wanted to be in the program. Berks County was successful. I know you'll be talking with Ken Pick and his team shortly to talk about how Berks County intends to implement it. The county is going to be receiving about $3.5 million. And my understanding is that they are operating a program specifically for the city, as well as for the rest of the county with different management. And I assume they're going to get into the details of, you know, exactly what it's going to look like and how much they can spend in Berks. It will not be $50,000 per homeowner, but they can give you the exact figure for it. They're trying to spread the money out as far as they can to help as many people as they can.
Yes, and I'm looking forward to hearing more details about the program. As somebody who's worked in the housing rehab industry for over 40 years, this is a huge accomplishment. And I want to thank the legislature for recognizing that, moving it forward. What do you think the odds are that the program will continue in the state budget for the foreseeable future?
Well, that's the million-dollar question here.
Right.
As I said, we're in Harrisburg now and we're working on the budget. Certainly there has been a request, and I've supported it, for $100 million to add into the program so that we can continue it. We haven't even rolled out the initial program yet, but already we understand that it will be oversubscribed. We're going to have more people who want to be in this program than we have money to actually provide. And, you know, folks that are, you know, qualified applicants may be turned away. So that's why we're thinking that we would really like to keep this program rolling. The fear is, and I share this fear, is that if we don't put it into this year's budget, the new one coming up, it's going to be a nice program that we had for 1 year, and then it's going to be harder to get the momentum to keep it going and to continue to refund it. It's probably something that we could fund for many years and still, you know, we could make a significant dent in, you know, some of the housing problems that we face in the Commonwealth, but not as significant as we'd like to see. So the question will be, You know, what's our spend number in this budget? And will there be an allocation for whole home repairs? It may not be 100 million. It may be, you know, less than that. We'll have to see what ultimately, you know, comes out of it. But for sure, we need to make sure something's in there, a placeholder, so that we can keep this program going. 1 year is not enough.
Thank you. That is so true. There is going to be a groundswell of interest in this program. If anyone is interested in communicating their support for the program, is there a particular way to do that?
Well, certainly they could email me. They could email their state representatives. They could email the governor's office to let them know. They could email not just me if I'm their senator, but all of the legislative delegation in Berks County, you know, because we're a Berks County program. So that certainly makes sense to do that. But the time is now. You know, we're supposed to have a budget by June 30th. Today's the 26th.
Right.
I'm not betting we're going to make it by the 30th, but I don't know for sure. So you have a little bit of time, but you really do need to. If you think this is a good thing, please, you know, let us know that you support it. We've had rallies in Berks County to discuss the program. And, you know, we know there's great interest in Berks. And by the way, there were three counties in the state that didn't even apply for the funding.
That
money will be reallocated to other counties. And, you know, it's kind of interesting as to, you know, how that happened. This was such a new program. Probably some counties didn't understand exactly what it could mean for them, or they don't have the infrastructure like we do in Berks to be able to actually implement the program. And I think you'll hear Ken say, because he said it to me, I've had conversations with him, that this program could be fine-tuned from the state standpoint, that there are, you know, more than just tweaks that we need to do. It's not just the money. The program has to be easy to implement, right? And, you know, streamline the red tape so that we can get that money out the door faster. So I'm very interested in hearing their experiences, because that we need to fix it. If there's problems, we need to fix it. But let's fund it too.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your words this morning and providing that context. And I'm looking forward to talking with Ken and his team shortly. But unfortunately, the show won't air until July, I forget, July 9th. But even so, we'll keep an eye on the progress of it through the budget. Well, thanks again.
Thanks for asking. Take care.
Our next guest will shed light on how the program is going to be administered locally. The Berks County Redevelopment Authority has been designated as the agency to run this program locally. In the studio, I have Ken Pick, the executive director of the authority, and Josh Lewis, the facilities and housing manager, who will administer the program for the properties outside the city of Reading. Habitat for Humanity will be managing the program for the authority for city homes. Ken has been the executive director of the Redevelopment Authority for over 20 years. He's been working in the area of community development and housing for over 45 years and holds a BS in buying and in education. His practical experience comes from being a former general contractor and buying and selling many of his own properties and heading nonprofit organizations. Having formerly lived in Berks County for 30 years, Ken and his wife now live in San Jose, California. Josh has been the facilities and housing manager at the Redevelopment Authority for almost 2 years. He has a master's degree in public administration from Kutztown. And prior to coming to the authority, he worked in construction for 20 years as a site foreman, eventually advancing to project manager. During the recession, John worked as a caseworker for the Commonwealth. Welcome, gentlemen. And I'm very excited to have you here to talk about something that's near and dear to our hearts. I know Ken and I have been working together for a very long time, and housing rehabilitation is always at the forefront of those conversations. Ken, I understand the Redevelopment Authority would be administering the whole home program and rehab. What experience does the authority have in addressing housing rehabilitation in Berks County?
Well, Karen, let me first mention that it's the Redevelopment Authority of the County of Berks.
Oh.
The city has their own Redevelopment Authority, but this is... Right. The county's redevelopment authority that's administering the program. Oh my gosh, probably we started housing rehabilitation programs in the late 70s. We have federal funds, local funds, state funds, you name it. And it's, you know, we've had programs and they died away, and then we have more program funding and rejuvenated those programs. So this is almost like another rejuvenation of our housing rehabilitation programs. It's very exciting that we can now get back into helping people and fix up their homes and make their homes safe. And very appreciative of the state providing these funds.
Yes, it's a really new adventure for the state, other than administrators of the federal CDBG program, NSP program, home program, and on the rest of the alphabet soup that HUD has thrown at us over the years. This is harkens back to many years ago when DCA, the precursor DCED, used to fund housing rehabilitation directly. So Habitat will be assisting the authority with projects in this city of Reading. Why is this important to city residents?
Well, Karen, yes, we contracted with Habitat for Humanity of Berks County to help with this program in this city. They have experience with city residents. They have experience in renovating houses in the city. We thought this would be a great collaboration, that they have some staff, we have staff, and we just kind of split it up. And it's very important for the city. As many of us know, there's a number of blighted properties in the city. The city has a housing problem in general. This is just a great way to help the city and help Habitat work on rehabilitating and rejuvenating the city, the city's housing stock.
So take a minute and describe the program such as you have it laid out now. Who's eligible to apply? How much can they receive? What kind of work will they get?
Well, there's two sections of the program. One is for homeowners and one is for small landlords. Right now we have it divided up where homeowners have a maximum grant amount of $24,900. This is for major systems of their home. It's for accessibility and it's for energy efficiency. So those are the three points that we're looking at. As far as what goes on there, they would apply, and later on we'll give them tell them how to apply, and then we would go out, look at the house, look at the project, determine whether it's something that's eligible, and work on getting them contractors out, getting bids in to perform the work that needs done, just to keep the housing stock up to date.
Is there an adequate supply of contractors to address the program? I heard COVID had a bit of a challenge for smaller contractors.
Things are definitely getting better. There's more availability between contractors. So the environment is loosening up enough that this is a good time to start.
Good to hear it. So how would people apply, in the city or not in the city? Is there separate application processes?
The application is not any different from being in the city or outside of the city. Our full launch date is July 5th. So that's when homeowners, anyway, will be able to apply. We're still working with the state DCED to get through some of the criteria for the landlord portion. So that's not going to be up and running yet. But July 5th will be the day that homeowners can go online and apply. Yeah. We have a website. It's bcwhrp.com. You should be able to just Google search Berks County Whole Homes Repair or Berks County WHRP to find that. When you get on that website, there'll be some facts, but it'll have links to take you to the application. The application process is run through Neighborly. It's very user-friendly. It's also mobile-friendly, it's bilingual, which is good for the city residents and people speaking Spanish. Those are the only two languages we have is English and Spanish right now, but you get to choose and you get the application. There'll be other places that link to that application as well. The county website, Redevelopment Authority's portion of the county website will also have a link for it.
Great. So if somebody is very technophobe and doesn't want to deal with that, is there any other way that they can apply?
Well, we ask that everyone at least make an attempt to apply online or to have someone assist them apply online. Clearly, we're not going to stop anyone from making an application if that's impossible. But, you know, we are asking for a partnership here. We do ask people to at least make the attempt. But there, as far as city residents, Habitat will have a few office hours open during the day. Our office is open as well. So someone that's having trouble can come in for assistance.
Well, that's a good option. when things with technology work, they were great, and when they don't work, it's extremely frustrating. So I can sympathize with people. So what are some of the things that people can do to make the project go smoothly? What makes for a good project?
Well, like I just stated, the partnership aspect of it, we don't want to tell people what contractors to use. We have a list of contractors we have used. It's not necessarily a suggestion. We're just saying these are people we used. I always say that they should do their research. This is a bid process. We do have to take the lowest bid. It's very important that they look at reviews for contractors or whatnot, because you might choose to know who you want and get a bid from them, and then you need a second bid and you'll just take anybody. That's probably not a good idea. Either one would have just the same a chance. We have to go with the low bidder, or else the property owner has to make up that difference in the amount. So
if my brother-in-law is a contractor and I want him to do the job, but he comes in higher, I can buy up to the price of that
job. You can buy up to the
job.
Price, yes.
Well, that makes people feel better about picking who they would like to have,
yes,
as long as they're reasonable.
What we don't want to do is we don't want to tell people they need to use this contractor or that contractor.
Right. But contractors have to meet certain criteria, though,
yes.
I hope.
They do have to be licensed, and they yes. do have to have workers' compensation. And we work. That doesn't have anything to do with the homeowner. We would work directly with the contractor to get that information.
Oh, good. Yeah, we don't want people to come in with their bills. I had hired Joe Smith, and he came and did my roof. Here's my bill. We've had that happen, unfortunately, in the course of rehab in the city many, many, many years ago, but it's really sad. So application's the first step,
yes.
and then go looking for contractors for who's going to write up what needs to be done.
After the application, the next step would be one of the housing techs, either if somebody from Habitat, if you're in the city, or my staff or myself would go out to a house and determine whether that project is eligible. And then we would do a work write-up based on what's needed and what the homeowner says they want. That work write-up would go out, be printed, so that they can give it to contractors and basically be comparing apples to apples.
At $24,900 for a homeowner, what do you think people will mostly be coming in to have done on their homes? That's not a lot of money anymore.
It's not a lot of money, but I mean, it would cover, you know, for most homes, it would cover like a new HVAC system or a new roof. Sometimes windows, accessibility is another thing. You're probably not going to be able to pick and choose a lot of those, but it will definitely cover one of them.
So we're not remodeling the kitchen just because.
No, it's not a program for aesthetics. It's, you know, it's to make sure that we keep the housing stock as good as we can, at least for the major systems of it.
So major systems include what? Roofs, water, sewer, electrical, plumbing.
All those things, yes.
All those things.
Sometimes even if a township or municipality is forcing people to put a sidewalk in or fix curbing, we would even do that as well.
I really like to encourage older residents who qualify for the Area Agency on Aging program for air conditioners to apply to get those 220 lines. Often they qualify for an air conditioner and can't get the air conditioner because they can't support
yes.
the electric line to make the air conditioner work. So that's been an unfortunate side effect of that program, is to find out how many homes don't have modern electricity to be able to run an air conditioner.
And there are a lot of situations where you would need more than one contractor. As you just mentioned, you might need an HVAC contractor and an electrical contractor to do something like that.
Yeah, that would be better to have two specialists,
yes.
I would guess. Maybe help with that. So how much does an authority have to spend altogether? And is there a separation of city and county, or is it one big pool?
Well, Karen, it's sounds like a lot of money, but it's not. It's $2,872,000. Now, to you and I and probably most people, that sounds like a great deal of money. It really is not. When you think about all the needs that's out there and all the issues, even that $24,900, it's not going to go too far.
It's roughly 1,000 houses, I guess.
No, not even that.
Not even that.
Yeah. 100 maybe a little over 100, 100 and some.
I was trying to figure out my zeros.
Everybody
there,
to
I
max
lost.
Out the, yeah. the program, but it could, you know, 150 maybe.
Yeah. Wow.
And we did not separate out this portion of the funds are available for the city and this portion of funds available for the boroughs and townships. We're just going to let it flow, so to speak.
We're not going to designate.
Is there any prioritizing of special needs? So it's really going to be a first come, first serve?
It's first come, first serve, but there is going to be some prioritization. Like if someone's roof is actively leaking as opposed to someone just needs a new roof, there's only so many roofing contractors in the county that we would, of course, push to get the one that needs done. Now, that doesn't mean that the other one wouldn't get done, but just for prioritization purposes, that's the only thing we'd be looking at.
That Judy Schwank mentioned just a short while ago that they're working on the budget as we speak, and they're hoping to put another round of money in for this program, potentially $100 million, although, what they come out with in Harrisburg is anyone's guess at this point. It's too early in the budget process. We will not have a budget by June 30th, I suspect, but we should have some idea if this program is still in the mix.
Well,
that's encouraging.
Yeah, that would be very worthwhile for the state to continue funding this program. This is now funded with funds from the American Rescue Plan that then the state is doling out to the counties. So that was a kind of a one-time shot. So if there's enough need, and I assume there will be, that would be wonderful if Harrisburg could see their way clear to allocate money, even on an annual basis, for this kind of effort. There's plenty of need out there.
And times are just different now than they were before. I mean, there are, like you mentioned, there are retired people that can't afford to fix, but at the same time, there isn't alternatives for them to go move.
Yeah.
Everything's tight right now, housing rent. So we can make an attempt to at least keep them in their house.
That's right. Handicap accessibility, I think we all think of this, the outside ramp, but what other kind of improvements do you think people might could come in for under that category?
Oh, well, if it's a two-story home and they need access to the second floor, it would be one of those
lift things.
Lifts, yes.
Yeah. Would you put a bathroom in on the first floor
if they need
that? Because I remember having some interesting stories with those with property lines.
Well, keep in mind, it's 24/9,
right.
So,
right.
But if that's a priority,
as
Josh said, that's one of the priorities. And that
right.
So
if an applicant is income eligible, what kind of income range are we? Should have brought it with me. What are we talking about off the top of our head, like a four-person household? Do you have a ballpark?
Well, it's 80% of the area median income, which for a family of four is 72, like 72-ish.
So we're not talking extremely low income.
Oh, no. No, not at all. Not at all.
And those levels are set by the state at this point?
Well, they use the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development standards. They adjust them every year, so
right.
It's just
June
15th.
Yeah, June 15th.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So mm-hmm. They go up a little bit each year.
Right.
And they do use the terminology low to moderate income in the program.
Right. Yeah, the state, I mean, we've all been such good bureaucrats with federal money for so long, it's hard probably to say this is state money and not federal money and we don't have to worry about some of the rules. Is the under 25,000 cap a reflection of the need to stay under the state prevailing?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
And just so for the audience, right. Anything 25,000 or more, you have to pay state prevailing wage rates on that construction job. And many, many counties across the Commonwealth are making their grants and their funds limit to be 24/9. If we would go higher, that would even further limit the number of contractors that would be out there willing to do that paperwork.
And not only that, you might be able to do $40,000 worth of work under wage rates, and it's equal to 24/9 without the wage rate.
Right.
So they're not really losing out in the long
run. The housing wage rates aren't so bad. It's the paperwork, it's the bureaucracy of doing it that I call a tabletop contractor. Is really going to struggle with, and that I think is our primary housing rehab contractor market. It's not the really big guys that have the office staff to go back and deal with it.
But even the rates, though, Karen, even the residential rates for Pennsylvania prevailing wage rate are probably higher than most contractors are paying out there, contractors that would be bidding on this work.
True.
So it adds cost to that project, as you said. Paperwork, we have to factor that in. How am I going to deal with this paperwork?
Right.
So it all adds, we're not saying there's anything wrong. Please don't get us wrong. There's nothing wrong with the act. I'm not saying that. It's just when we look at what we're doing, and many counties are doing the same thing, as I mentioned, that we want to keep it under there so we're sure we can get enough contractors. And
I think that was important to mention because, you know, the act, if anybody wants to read anything that's come out of Harrisburg, talks about a $50,000 cap, but it's really very hard to do that with all these other concerns.
It is.
So, what might cause a homeowner to be ineligible, even if they have a low to moderate income?
So if they are income eligible, except the first thing after the application is we determine that eligibility, whether income eligible or not, but then we go to the house to see if the project is actually eligible. Yeah. The big thing that we're looking for is we want to use this money to keep houses and keep houses out there for the citizens of Berks County. If it's a house that is just so bad, so dilapidated that the 24-9 that we can see that it's not going to do much to improve it, we don't want to waste that money that could go to someone else that would be more useful.
Somebody needs a roof and windows and a heating system and a sidewalk and you're talking $100,000. This is not the program.
This program's not going to get your house up to code or to where it needs to be. So in that case, we would look at other alternatives, but you wouldn't use it for this program.
Yeah.
And the program wasn't designed to do that either. It was designed to, as Josh was saying, hit some of those major things and just kind of stabilize. This is not a total rehab program. Not designed that, even from the state.
Yeah, we used to be able to do total rehab, but between the cost of everything and the lead paint, the radon, and the labor rates and lead hazard control, it just got to the point where nobody was finding that to be feasible, short of taking an empty house and maybe turning those around. The Redevelopment Authority's been doing quite a bit of that. Yeah.
But Karen, that was back in the 80s when you and I were...
I know, when $25,000 was a lot of money. I remember fighting to get the cap from 15 to 20. Yeah. That was crazy.
Yeah,
when you think
long
back.
Time ago.
Yeah. So long what time. Is happening with the landlord part? What are you envisioning, and even if it's tentative at this point?
Well, there's a landlord portion in this program. However, the state is still clarifying a number of terminologies and procedures and so forth. So we're really not ready to roll that out yet.
Right.
There's nothing wrong with what they're doing. They're trying to help us clarify some of their requirements and terminology. So it's just, we'll be delayed a little bit.
Right. So if you are a small landlord that owns a small properties, 1, 2, 3, 4 unit type properties, you're the target market, but it's not quite ready yet.
Not quite ready yet from the state. And they're doing a good job of trying to answer our questions and clarify issues.
Yeah, rental rehab is always the most tricky. I guess you remember back in, the 90s, we tried a rental rehab program through HUD, and it was very, very difficult, both for the landlords as well as for the city to do, between tenant questions and income and costs and long-term affordability. It really was tying everybody's hands together.
And you mentioned small landlords. That is the same terminology that the state is using. So they're looking for landlords that have 5 units or less, 15 units or less, and five places or less.
Oh, wow.
So and this isn't based on the landlord's income, unless they happen to be residing in the place that's getting rehabbed. But this isn't based on the landlord's income. This is based on the tenant's income and actually keeping low-income tenants in the unit after it's rehabbed.
Yeah, that's where the rubber hits the road in these programs. And the long-term monitoring, is the Redevelopment Authority going to have to track all of that?
Yes, annually, yes.
And but not on the homeowner side, just the tenant side. So and for homeowners, it's once and done on the income, and they have, 5 years to pay it back?
They don't have to pay it back.
Okay, explain that. Because that's important.
It's a forgivable loan.
Yeah.
So what we're looking for is we want homeowners to stay in the home that we fixed up for them. They don't have to. They're not required to. But we have it set up as a forgivable loan. So for 10 years, that loan will be there. And every year on the anniversary date of the completion, it'll be reduced by 10%. So
if you get $24,000, it becomes $22,000 the next year, something like 21.6. My math is right.
Make it 20, then you can do it.
Yeah, there you go.
Really
you do it in the head. Yeah.
You get 20, but then it's
$2,000 a year. Right.
But we are looking for homeowners that are that are trying to flip their house. We expect that they're going to get this stuff done, and they're they're going to stay there for as long as they possibly can, and then they don't have any worries about paying anything back.
Right. Can a family member assume the remaining balance if they stay, if they move into the home? Mom gets the loan, mom has to go to Berksheim or whatever. One of the kids is staying in the home, do they assume?
Whenever the deed changes hands, that's when they would come in to recoup whatever's owed. So if someone were to go to a home and there would be a family member there, as long as the house isn't being sold, they could, they could sit on the waiting to be fully forgiven.
But they can't turn it into a rental at that point. They can't, even if it's not sold, the family members can't say, well, let's rent out mom's home. They'd have to.
They'll catch you.
Well, in the city, that would be helpful because the city has a rental registration.
Yes.
So they can flag these in the GIS and hopefully in the permit process. And
many
stop
municipalities
it.
Do as well. It's not just the
do
city.
They? Yeah. Good. Yeah. Good. It's good to hear that that's technology is spreading. It makes it so much easier to keep track of all these things that have been happening. We've had 40 different programs over the last 30 years. Each one has its own twists and turns that are increasingly difficult for the staffs to keep track of. When the July 5th date comes and you are and the website crashes because you'll have so many applications and you'll receive hundreds of applications, how soon do you think people would be start to hear from you that they've been accepted?
Or they should hear from us relatively soon. I mean, the first step, the neighborly application, the way it's set up, for them to move through the application, it asks for them to download things. I did mention it's mobile friendly, so you don't necessarily have to have a scanner at home. You can use your phone and take pictures of your paycheck, for instance. But inevitably, we're not going to have all the information that we need. So the first step would be when that application comes in, we'll have someone doing intake. And they'll probably be calling you if you make an application and asking you for a pay stub or something in that order.
I would think it's very important for people to be prepared to respond timely because they'll keep moving back in the queue if they don't.
Yes. So, to Josh's point, if you have everything that you need for the application and can finish it, and we check it fairly quickly, and it could be... Mm-hmm.
Oh, it could be just a matter of, if everything's there and we find that they're income eligible, it would just be a matter of days till we're at least calling them to make the appointment to go out to their house anyway. Yeah. So they'll hear from us.
Good. Because this program is scheduled to run, I think, the day 2 days after your release date or something like that.
Or, this program.
Yeah.
This,
Rise, we're speaking now. We're broadcasting a little bit later. So hopefully there'll still be slots available for people who are hearing this program. And if not, again, there... Hopefully, will be more money coming down the pike, and all's not lost if you're more than the 100th in the queue. And we want to assure you that this could be very helpful to you at some point, if not this year, hopefully down the road, to stay in touch with the Redevelopment Authority and stay in touch with the city to find out how these opportunities are generated. These are very good dollars to have, a lot more flexibility than the federal dollars.
Yeah, and that's good, even though we have $2,872,000, so to speak, we need to obligate that, not spend it, obligate it by the end of next year. So we do want people to apply. You really should have all your paperwork, ready, apply when you can, because we are... Mm-hmm. Running this program,
And it's our intention to use every bit of that money.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's
the biggest way that the state knows it was successful.
Oh, I was going to say, it's hard to imagine that you won't be. So what kind of things, if somebody is listening and they want to jump in there and get their application and they didn't do it July 5th, but they're doing it on the day they hear this, what kind of things besides their pay stubs would they possibly need to provide you with?
Looking at eligibility and the eligibility criteria, as obviously they need to own the home. They need to be up to date on taxes. If someone just might own a small amount and this is more valuable for them to apply and get this program, then I would be looking to pay off whatever they owe in back taxes because we can't really proceed with their application until that's done. That's one of the things, yes.
Yeah. How about water and sewer bills? People are payment plans, so that's not going to come into play at this time.
No.
Are you going to be able to check deed records at the courthouse? They need to have their deed.
That's for our process. That's the first thing that we're doing. We're looking to see whether they're actually in the city or outside of the city, so we know who to assign it to, and then we're looking at back taxes.
Yeah. And we have access, and the general public does too. Right. You can go research a deed, see who owns it. We have the ability to do that.
Back in the day, we used to have people go to the courthouse, pay for a copy, get their deed, bring it in. I mean, it was a major production, but now you can click in the button, you can get it. That's
see
helpful.
How technology works. It's
it
like
does.
Super.
It
really
is. It's a miracle. I said that earlier. The miracle of Zoom. We were able to include Senator Schwank in the conversation and to hear how it's going at the Commonwealth level. So pay stubs is basically the main thing. Tax returns.
Well, source of income.
Source of income.
Let's make it.
Do you need tax returns? Do you need to know how many people are in? You need something that tells how many people are in.
Yes, we do need to know how many people are in the household. We need income verification, whatever income might be. The state wants 2 months of income verification for if it's a job, if you're on Social Security, just the Social Security award letter, at least the most current one, 2023 one. We're not looking at child support. They don't even need to put that on the application. We're not looking at income for 18 and under. So we're just looking at adults in the household and their income.
So backing up to the Social Security, so you get your statement, beginning of the year, federal fiscal year in October, November. What if you don't have it sitting around anymore? What if?
You can go in and log in and get it.
It's a technology thing.
It's a technology thing.
Again, yes.
And I'm sure we can get help for anyone who needs that help through the Area Agency on Aging or others who know how to navigate. I just did it the other day and I can't think of what it's called. But yeah.
It's
when you have
My
to go
Security,
in and
Social Security,
it.
Something.
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah, My Something. It's actually, I was surprised in the couple years I've been using it since I hit that magic age. It's actually gotten easier to use.
Yes.
So it isn't the be-all and end-all. And again, there are probably some of the human service organizations working with people that might be able to navigate this as well and help people to get this done. It's so important. For those older folks who, I know this is a huge problem we used to run into this city, the older people didn't want to put a lien on their property. They wanted to die leaving their home free and clear for their kids. What have you got to say about that?
It's a lien on your property.
It's a lien on your property.
But your property is going to be more valuable as well.
So. There you go. And you're going to be safe. And that should be your kids' primary reason or rationale for you pursuing a program. They're not going to inherit something that's ready to fall down. They're going to want to inherit or unsafe, right? They're going to want you to live comfortably and inherit something that's got some value to it. So I was just given the 10-minute flag. So I just wanted to explain a little bit about the League of Women Voters. We are a 100-year-old plus organization, open to men and women. We have a very active group that encourages an informed and active participation in government. We have all kinds of voter outreach events that are gearing up now for the summer for the midterm elections that are coming up, which are all local, by the way. So it's really important. People don't show up for local elections. If you don't show up for local elections, you don't get the people who can go to Harrisburg and represent these programs. You have got to show up to vote. If you don't show up, then you can't complain. And if you need to register, you need to change your address, you need to do any of those things, now's the time to be checking that voter registration and getting that done. And you can do that through votepa.gov. You can also find a link to that, vote411.org, or even the League's website at League of Women Voters, lwvberks.org. But again, that votepa.gov is your first stop for voting information. We will have representation, a lot of community events over the summer, so look for our little booth, and we are happy to help you as well with voter registration. So these are the issues that we want to bring to the public's attention, the opportunity to have this kind of funding for the first time in like forever is quite a feather in the state legislator's cap to make this available. And we hope people will definitely take advantage of it and be able to support the legislators who support these kind of programs.
And Karen, we want to thank you and the League for having us on the program and helping to get out the word, too. Thank you very much. And
Our pleasure.
For you and the league. Yeah. It's important that the message gets out about this program.
It is. We've been involved now. The league took on housing as its hot topics for the year last year and sponsored a roundtable of local municipal officials, which has now been, the issue has now been risen to a county level issue through the Imagine Berks process.
Correct.
And so this is definitely part of the link in that chain. This is definitely the first step is maintaining the existing housing stock, helping people to stay in their homes, correct, to maintain those homes, to be safe in those homes, and then to make those homes available for the next generation as a, you know, as a stepping stone into stable housing and wealth creation and all those good, sure, things. Yeah. So without housing in Berks County, we wouldn't have opportunity to bring in employers or sustain growth within employers in locally. And these are the issues that Imagine Berks is tackling. So we're very proud to be part of that process as well. And again, it all starts with voting. I'll say it one last time, and then we'll say have a good afternoon. But you want to check your registration, votepa.gov, and you want to come out and vote at the midterm elections this fall. So with that, I want to say thank you again, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Appreciate
talking with you.
Thank you.
And have a good day.
Thank you.